Your Excellencies, Honorable Minister, Member of National Delegation and Diplomatic Corps, my colleagues, friends, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me a great pleasure and honor to be deliver this statement in the opening of the 2012 World Water Week, an event to which both Stockholm at the heart of the world for all those who are sincerely concerned with the future of our Earth, its water resources, the well-being of the dwellers, and their rights to attain a fair share of its resources. In my capacity as the Minister of Water Resources and Irrigation of Egypt, I would like to convey to you the greeting and hopes of 85 million Egyptians who led in January 2011 one of the world's most decent and peaceful revolution in search for fair share of food, freedom, justice, and dignity. The Egyptian revolution is inducing radical change in various fields of Egyptian life to restore its ability to play historical role and supporting flourishing civilization. In striving to do so, water has always been primary resources and a limiting crucial factor for development within privileged, hyper and arid environment. Accordingly, food, energy, ecological footprint, and various socioeconomic activities are all hanging on water resources and its proper management. More than 7,000 years ago, the Egyptians started strategic planning for water management through control and regulation of the Nile water. The pharaohs established the cradle of civilization as a gift from the Nile, as narrated by Herodotus. Today, the water demand are about 80 billion meter cubed per year, while the Nile supplies a constant renewable surface water of about 55.5 billion meter cubed per year. In practical, the absence of rain, about 2 billion meter cubed per year of fossil groundwater are being abstracted. The rest of the demand are satisfied through intensive water recycling in the form of reused treated wasted water, recycled mixed agricultural drainage water, and recycle of excess irrigation water, recharging the Nile alluvial aquifer. A triple cycle of reuse provide more than 25% of our demand is not uncommon. An overall national irrigation efficiency of more than 80% is achieved, and which is among the highest in the world. Amongst all renewable natural resources of the world, fresh water is mere and sole resources upon which the existence of life depends, be it in form of the stream flow, groundwater, soil moisture, or atmospheric water vapor. Fresh water present potential livelihood to the different form of lives. Water resources, although globally abundant, are distributed in pronounced uneven patterns throughout the globe. Global renewable water surface and the ground resources amount for an average annual share of near 7,000 meter cubed per capita per year. Had these resources been evenly distributed throughout the land? The greatest water availability is estimated near of 150,000 meter cubed per capita per year in the northern area and Oceania, while at the same time, the North Africa and on the Arabian Peninsula, it is as low as 200 to 300 meter cubed per capita per year of renewable resources. Global water withdrawal for irrigation presents nearly about 66% of the total abstraction and up to 90% in arid region. As world population is increasing and the lifestyle are changing, more water being reallocated from food production towards satisfying human need. Changing climate and extended variability makes the future of water and the food production is highly uncertain. Uncertainty is in many times due to factors and the choices which are made collectively by the world people. These factors include income and population growth, investment in water infrastructure, allocation of water to various uses, reform in water management, and technological change in agriculture. 10 years ago, it has been concluded that if the traditional and the current water policies continue to prevail, farmers will indeed find it is difficult to meet the food need for 9 billion persons striving for survive by the year 2025. The world's poorest population will be the most affected. Practical solutions have been foreseen to have the following implications. First, more efficient water use. Second, improve crop productivity per unit of water through integrated water management and agricultural research and policy effort, including crop breeding and water management for rain-fed agriculture. And third, phasing out of improper groundwater management. My colleagues, friends, and distinguished guests, in my capacity as the President of African Minister Council on Water, I would first like to, on behalf of my colleagues at AMCOW, many of whom have honored the invitation of organizers of the World Water Week and are here today, to thank the organizers, the Stockholm International Water Institute, and the International Organizing Committee of the World Week for opportunity it provides every year for the African voice to be heard as the world gathers to discuss the challenges we face concerning the effective use of water sources to improve our life. The scarce availability of water for domestic need and food production defines a bitter experience for the million of people in African continent. Latest figure from the snapshot of drinking water and sanitation in Africa of year 2012 update shows that whereas 322 million people in Africa gained access to an improved drinking water source since 1990, the population relying on unimproved drinking water sources increased from 279 million in 1990 to 344 million in 2010. Over 500 million lack access to improved sanitation. Moreover, the water sector in Africa faces a financing gap of more than $8.5 billion per year, US dollar. Available evidence suggests that the financing gap is at least 30% of the total annual financing need. To minimize this gap, appropriate investment plan must be developed in order to promote domestic as well as foreign financial resources allocated for implementing national and regional water and sanitation development activities. While an individual daily drinking requirement is approximately 3 liters per day, the same person will need about 3,000 liters of water to produce his or her daily food. This means that because we do not have sufficient water for food production, more people are going hungry with the day. Statistics reveal that billions of people are suffering from object hunger in the world already, threatened by water stress. So it is becoming increasingly evident that without placing water, an engine of growth, and without water being the heart of the development planning, ongoing effort to ensure food security or scale up development in Africa, and indeed over the developing region may not yield the desired outcome. Africa will have the boost its agricultural yield per available hectare if we have to ensure food security. Recalling that 80% of agriculture in the continent is rain-fed and subject to climate change variability, we need to implement well-designed scheme with supplemental irrigation plots, and that will require the development and the harnessing of water infrastructure to minimize extensive water loss, to utilize groundwater resources in sustainable manner, to ensure proper water allocation at the proper timing, with special attention to mitigate climate change vulnerabilities. Another challenge is that also Africa is endowed with abundant water resources. The resources are highly unutilized bitter, with only about 4% developed from water supply, irrigation, and hydropower generation. The per capita water storage in the continent is less than 100 cubic meter. Building dam is not restricted to large scale dam, but reform also to small dams that are largely committed to empowering poor rural farmers by equipping them with water-related infrastructure that will enable them to cultivate crop on a sustainable basis. An extreme hydropower generation is a very viable option for improving valuable community services. Looking back to the challenges listed in Africa, water vision, we can identify extra work need to be done with respect to building capacities, reforming institutions, improving governance, empowering local participatory management, raising awareness, and mobilizing the political will and engaging African women and youth. Permit me, therefore, to say that this year's theme, Water and Food Security, aligns with the objective of the AMCOW to adopt water for growth in Africa as the driving focus of our work to the next decade as we strive to achieve the 2025 Africa Water Vision. The fourth African Water Week hosted by the government of Egypt in Cairo enabled AMCOW to pay renewed and devoted attention to water for growth, building a new form of orientation of the year 2008, first African Water Week, which titled Towards Water for Social and Economic Development. Let me restate that the AMCOW realized the crucial importance of increasing our effort to implement past declaration of integrated management of water resources to advance well-being of Africa people, economy, and environment. AMCOW minister commit to bringing solutions that added value, and we pledge that these commitments will honored. We shall work together with our development and other partners to achieve the target we set ourselves within set time frame. It is my sincere hope that the time we spent at this conference to deliberate at the various workshops, seminars, and side events will help us to strategize further, share best practice, and sharpen our tool to achieve our common goal and objectives. Let me use this opportunity to invite you to our Africa Focus tomorrow from 9 a.m. as we explore the theme of water scarcity opportunities for 21st century. Ladies and gentlemen, Your Excellencies, I would like to conclude my statement with the following messages. We regretfully admit that the food nutrition sufficiency experience great spatial variability across the globe. The gap between those who are over-endowed with plenty of food and those underprivileged in food production is alarming growing. The former gap usually refer to water endowed nation versus water deprived nation. The result is the same human perish due to hunger and famine, while other humans are seeking energy out of their surplus food to drive their cars. We regretfully to admit that some humans in their strive for prosperity have triggered a change in climate with several impacts. Other humans who last contribute to global warming will be bearing most of the determinal consequences. The African continent as a whole is an example of this. My country, Egypt, is specifically subject to devastating losses due to sea level rise, shift in agricultural pattern, extreme climate event, seawater intrusion, and augmentation of aridity and water scarcity. Substantial reduction in GDP are expected. We acknowledge full right of each individual in any nation of this globe for fair share of water, food, and energy. I will provide every possible effort and support to direct AMCOW to achieving as much as possible of the former right. Integrated water resources management may be potentially credible approach for managing the water, food, energy nexus. Benefit sharing with win-win perspective and under an umbrella of ethics, a prerequisite to comfort inherent disputes and uncertainties. Achieving the Millennium Development Goal for water supply and sanitation coupled with appropriate water recycling and the reduction of post-harvesting wastes will reflect positively on food sufficiency. Monitoring and evaluation is one of the powerful performance management tools that could help to achieve regional commitment in the water sector. Green economy, in its broad sense as a low carbon resources efficient and socially inclusive economy, carries on one hand the promise a new economic growth paradigm that is suitable to Earth ecosystem and can also contribute to poverty elevation. On the other hand, it may be imply more monopoly and more control of market shares. We strongly call for more support for developing countries in order to adapt their economies to the greening concept rather than banalizing them for not being able to cope with the green economy requirements. A global adaptive financing mechanism may be beneficial. Cooperation rather than competition and collaboration rather than individual action paves the road towards fruitful and transparent transboundary water management. Excellences, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you all for your time and wish you successful deliberation through the week. Thank you very much and see you.